Tonight we're going to be taking a look at a brand new counseling issue. Of course, this is counseling issues. This is counseling issues 1, and we're taking a broad overview of the various counseling issues that will be addressed in your role as a counselor. Tonight we're going to be looking at interpersonal issues, and we're also going to be looking in the second hour at abuse issues. Okay? Some of the interpersonal issues would relate to self-esteem, self-worth, communication. Let's take a look, first of all, at some of the problems that are encountered in interpersonal relationships. What are some of the causes of problems in interpersonal relationship? Well, the first is we can always blame the devil, right? We can always say that there is a satanic involvement. Well, let me make that clear that, yeah, we can certainly say that if there's any way possible that Satan can bring a division between people, he'll certainly do that. And we know that he's an author of confusion and division. The Bible says behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like the anointing oil that flows down from the head and goes down on the beard of Aaron and down to his feet. The Apostle Paul warned against the divisions that existed among the members of the early church, of the first century. Human beings are social creatures. And at the time of creation, God said that it was not good for human beings to be alone. He gave Adam a companion, instructed the human race to multiply, and has permitted us to expand into the billions of people who now occupy planet Earth. And the truth of the matter is, you'll never have a successful marriage until you learn how to deal with interpersonal problems. You'll never have a relationship, a proper relationship between you and your employer until you understand something about interpersonal relationships. First of all, before we kind of jump the gun a little bit in looking at our slides here, and so we'll kind of take our attention away from that, and let me give you a little bit more background information about interpersonal relationships as the Bible addresses. The book of Proverbs is a good source of teaching about good relationships between people. The Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' teaching on the Sermon on the Mount concerns interpersonal relations. Paul warned Timothy not to be quarrelsome, especially over unimportant things. Other Bible passages offer instructions to live in harmony, to demonstrate love, and to replace bitterness and wrath with kindness, forgiveness, and tender-hearted actions. Good interpersonal relations begin with Jesus Christ. In fact, it's been said that all relationships are either vertical or horizontal, right? Forming the shape of a cross. Horizontal relationships meaning what? Relationships between us and our fellow man. And vertical relationship referring to our relationship with God. And Jesus made it very clear. I give Jesus specific credit, but it's the writings of John, in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd epistles of John, the Word of God tells us the importance of relating properly with one another. In other words, there's really no way that you can say your relationship is intact with God if it's not intact with people. And vice versa, that our relationship with people may determine what our relationship is with God. You can't say you love God and you hate your brother. And so they both work in conjunction with one another. We have to have a good relationship between us and the Heavenly Father. And the truth of the matter is, if you're out of sorts with God, you're going to be out of sorts with everybody else. If you're not where you ought to be spiritually, then you're setting yourself up for all kinds of conflict. And one of the real important skills that can be taught, and of course counseling can be a form of training. There are different aspects of counseling. You have preventive counseling. You have, then of course you have crisis intervention. But teaching skills is a very important part of counseling. And one of the important skills is teaching communication, good communication patterns. Learning how to be a good listener. Learning how to speak clearly, definitively, with understanding. A very important part of counseling, especially of a preventive nature, would be in the teaching of conflict resolution. You're not going to necessarily avoid conflicts. In fact, we could probably pretty safely say that conflicts are going to be inevitable. You're going to have conflicts. And it's not always in learning how to cover up. See, a lot of times people think, well, you know, you just learn how to avoid certain things. Well, that may be one good thing, that if you know something is going to be controversial, that if there's nothing positive that's going to come out of some type of controversy or some confrontation, the best thing to do is to avoid it. There are things that we ought to be able to avoid. In other words, you shouldn't just simply do something for the specific purpose of antagonizing someone, especially someone you're in a close relationship with. However, you do not do that at the expense of just simply withdrawing and not dealing with an issue. In other words, even at the expense of being controversial and at the expense of creating conflict, there are times we have to hit problems head on, or else there will be no resolution to it. So learning how to resolve, not necessarily learning how to live with, not necessarily learning how to deal with, but learning how to resolve conflicts is very important. Okay? And of course, good interpersonal relations depend on personal traits. There are some people easier to get along with than other people, right? The Bible says that we're to, if possible, we're to what? Live peaceably with all men, at least giving us the possibility that it may not be possible. That's at least what I gather from it. But I think that there are most definitely, in most situations, there are possibilities of finding a common area of agreement and learning how to live peacefully with one another. But there may be some situations where you just absolutely cannot deal with a situation. So what you have to do, you just have to simply do what you know to do and leave the rest of that up to God. What are some personal traits that would be antagonistic toward good interpersonal relationship? Now we say that good interpersonal relations depend on personal traits. First of all, let's identify some personal traits that would be that would work in contradiction to or that would create a situation that would make it more difficult. What would be some personality traits? What would be some attributes, characteristics? What would be some areas of weakness that we could take a look at to seek to reinforce or to strengthen? Self-centered, selfish. What would be some others? Critical personality. personality, critical attitude, know-it-all, having all the answers, never wrong, not seeing somebody else's point of view, intolerance, impatience. What would be some others? Have you ever seen personalities that you just absolutely, you would try to even avoid, you wouldn't even want. And probably most of those personality traits would be some of the things I've already mentioned. There's some people who are going to seek to find a controversy. It doesn't make any difference. It doesn't make any difference what the situation is. They're going to be confrontational. They're going to be uncouth. So some of the good positive things would be gentleness, kindness, love, concern, understanding,
compassionate,
broad-minded, open-minded. For real peace to be felt within or to occur between individuals, there must first be a peace with God. Good interpersonal relations also involve determination, effort, and skill. If you're just simply going to seek the path of least resistance, first of all, you could become passive. Sometimes it's easier just to avoid a situation and you say, well, you get along, but then you go up, you're resentful. I mean, you still have this resentment in your heart and you haven't really dealt with the issue. And even though you may not be openly antagonistic, you don't have the openness with that individual that would create at least an environment of honesty, of a really open communication. Sharing your heart, being transparent. So many times you have to work at good communication, right? You have to work at conflict resolution. You have to work at good interpersonal relations. It takes effort. It takes skill. And I think that sometimes that people are just simply they're lacking in the skill, are they not? I mean, that's where. Again, that's where training can come in helping to teach people certain skills. Consistent development and application of skills such as listening carefully. Not listening to someone, one thing that communicates is disrespect. And that may be in not giving the appearance that you're listening. That might be in not having proper eye contact. And can be a certain amount of disrespect. Another skill is watching, observing. Another skill is understanding others, oneself and others. There's a skill of refraining from unkind comments or emotional outbursts. What's the reason why that sometimes we have a difficult time in refraining ourselves? Why? What is often the motivation there? The motivation, many times, not refraining ourselves, is what we consider to be the preservation of our self-respect or of our esteem, not wanting our ego to be challenged. Not wanting someone to gain the upper hand, not wanting someone to have the last word, right? So that can, just in learning how to refrain yourself from unkind comments, you're thinking, well, boy, I'm not wanting to let that slide by and for them to think that they got an advantage over me. the skill of communicating accurately. Communication is a true or false. Communication is a two-way street. It's absolutely true. Communication means what? Speaking clearly, speaking so that the other person understands, getting your message across in a way that's understandable, and then of course it requires the person on the other end listening, learning how to listen properly. Okay, now we're ready to take a look, a little closer look at the causes of problems in interpersonal relationships. I can say that Satan is certainly the author of confusion. He is he's certainly at the root of division. And at the very least, I would say this, that if Satan is not directly involved, he certainly must be rejoicing. And because you're certainly adding strength to, or he's adding strength to whatever it is that's bringing separation and division. The scripture talks so much about being of the same mind, being of the same purpose, going in the same direction. Okay? And probably a little bit more of elaboration on some of the things that we talked about as far as good relationships depending on personal traits. A self-centered need to be noticed. To be in control, to have one's own way, or to have money, prestige, and status. All of those attitudes can lead to problems. What about a non-forgiving, bitter attitude? Non-forgiving, bitter attitude. What about communication failure? Okay? So we have self-centeredness, we have an non-forgiving, bitter attitude, tendency to be hypercritical, judgmental, angry. What about insecurities? How can insecurities lead to a poor relationship? Fear of rejection.
Okay. What you mean, what you feel, because you're afraid of being rejected.
Fearful of being rejected, okay. So then again, we seek to protect ourselves, okay. Insecurities, okay. A person who is secure in the way they feel and what they are very free to develop a proper relationship with another individual. Okay, what about prejudice? Prejudice can certainly contribute. And of course, prejudice is not always recognized. There's some people who don't really recognize that they are being prejudiced. What about the unwillingness to open up, or the inability to open up and share one's feelings and thoughts? A failure or unwillingness to recognize individual differences. This is the erroneous idea that not everybody thinks, feels, and sees situations in a similar way. Okay? And of course, we can certainly say that interpersonal problems are more prevalent when difficult people are involved. There are some people that have the personality of sandpaper. But what does the Bible say about abrasive type personality? Or maybe that's not the proper thing. We think about abrasive personalities as being in conflict with one another, rubbing against one another. I guess that would be what I'm really seeking for. What does the Bible say about iron against iron? Iron against iron can be frictional, right? There can be friction between iron. But what does the Bible say about iron against iron? Iron sharpeneth iron. situation where there may not be all of this flowing together, but it gives you an opportunity, right? It gives you an opportunity to work through difficulty. It gives you an opportunity, as we say, to rub off the rough edges. In other words, sometimes there can be a person who's in agreement with you on every issue may not be very conducive for growth. So should someone that has a different personality than we, should that be the reason for us to separate ourselves from them, or for us to fail to seek to work things out and to be cooperative in agreement? In other words, are you always going to find people that are going to agree with you? No. Okay, and especially true in the family of God, in the body of Christ, you're going to have all kinds of personalities, aren't you? We're going to have plenty of opportunities. Every one of us is going to have plenty of opportunities. Okay, so abrasive personalities that are arrogant, cynical. What do we mean by cynical attitude? What is a cynical individual? What do we mean by cynicism? Basically, cynicism is questioning the motives of other people, which is critical, being judgmental, critical. But specifically, cynicism refers to questioning other people's motives. Okay? What about personalities that explode in anger when they don't get their own way? How comfortable is it to live with someone that's an active volcano ready to explode at any moment? It wouldn't be very comfortable, would it? What about complainers? Find fault with everything, but never do anything about their complaints. Now, here's one that I think a lot of people don't really recognize how antagonistic it can be. What about silent, unresponsive individuals who are difficult because they say very little and rarely reveal what they are thinking or doing? That can be very frustrating, right? And I think sometimes that can be frustrating for anybody, be it frustrating for a man or a woman. I think a lot of times maybe men have a tendency to practice this more so than women, because as a general rule, I think if, and there are differences in the way that men and women react and communicate and interact, and I think as a general rule, at least this is what John Gray says, and John Gray is the modern day expert, you know. No, in all seriousness, John Gray, if you don't know who he is, he's a guy that wrote Men Are From Mars and Women Are From Venus, and his whole idea of the differences there is that he says that certainly women have a tendency to want to talk about things more so than men. Women seem to be more verbal. They seem to want to have more details. And men oftentimes have a tendency just simply to clam up and not talk and be non-responsive. That can be very frustrating. Sometimes this can be passive aggressiveness. What about someone's always saying, well, whatever you propose, it just won't work? Pessimistic. Know-it-all, experts, condescending, verbose, unwilling to cooperate. Sure, you know, all these things we're talking about makes it much more difficult. Okay, let's take a look at failure in communication. Now, what are we talking about? What's our topic? What is the basic issue we're talking about? Interpersonal relations, right? Okay, let's take a look at communication failure. The process of communication is hindered if, first of all, the sender is unclear about his or her message. Unclear, and this can be in assuming that people hear you. I hope it things. It doesn't mind me using her as an example. If she does, she's in trouble because I've been using her and her family for 40 years now. But sometimes we're assuming that somebody hears. First of all, if we don't speak loud enough, and especially when you get a little bit older, you get a little bit harder of hearing, and you're not as articulate, how are you going to communicate? So you have to be, first of all, you have to get a person's attention. You can't get in another room and, you know, and holler above the sound of a window air conditioner, right? And mumble something and expect to communicate. There are certain situations. Some guys seem to get lost in their sports, and anytime they're watching some sporting activity is no good time to communicate. So I guess sometimes the best thing to do is that if it's important enough, turn the television off and communicate, right? But when the sender is unclear in his or her message, when the sender is afraid, ashamed, deceptive, or otherwise reluctant to send a clear message, or the sender does not put the message into clearly understandable words or gestures, the sender says one thing but conveys a different message by behavior. This is what we call incongruence. Congruence just simply means what? Being in alignment with or in agreement with. Incongruence refers to being out of alignment in your verbal and your nonverbal. Incongruence would mean that you say one thing with your mouth, but you demonstrate something else with your nonverbal behavior. You can say with your mouth everything's okay, but you can have a little smirk on your face, a little frown, or some sign of disgust that says something else. So that person is incongruent. The more congruent you are, is more that your verbal is in agreement with your nonverbal, and it comes across as being much more genuine. You come across as a much more genuine individual. And again, the sender mumbles, yells, or in other ways distorts the message so it is not sent clearly. I think sometimes when people are angry and they're seeking to communicate with one another, and I guess probably the best illustration we can use in the most intimate relationship that we can talk about is a marriage, right? Art, what type of relationship would be a close second probably to a marital relationship as far as, what's that?
Parent-child.
Okay. That's a biggie, isn't it? That's a huge area of disagreement and misunderstanding, especially between a parent and an adolescent. Okay, what would be another relationship, another potentially important relationship that would require good communication?
Siblings, there's employer-employee.
Siblings. Employer-employee, very, very important. Wonder why it is that, say for example, you know, sometimes we say we're not in control. You know, and isn't that the reason sometimes we have explosive situations, we have poor interpersonal relations? Because we seem to lose control. In other words, we maybe get angry and have an outburst, and we more or less say, well, you know, we didn't have control over ourselves, or we couldn't help ourselves. Is that totally true? I mean, what kind of validity do you think you really have in the statement, you know, that you have this uncontrolled temper? What would be a response there? What would be a particular situation, a potential situation that would contradict that?
Well,
not sure making, am I communicating? Am I making myself clear? Let me see if I can make my intents clear. Here's a person, well, we'll use a husband-wife. And as we say, that is a very common relationship, a very important relationship, one that is potentially rewarding and one that is very potentially explosive, right? It can lead to the very best of a relationship, of real close intimacy, or it can lead to extreme alienation. Okay, we'll use a husband-wife relationship. What do you say in response to a man, we'll use a man for example, that has these outbursts of rage and he says, well, I just can't help myself. You know, it's just something, I lose control. What would be a potential response to that? What would be a possible contradiction to that?
Serious consequences.
But what happened to that same guy if his wife says this is enough, and the next time you pull something like this, you know, you hit the road. Okay? So you have to look at what? The potential payoff. You have to look at the consequences. Okay, so it's a matter of respect. And the whole point here is that if you can control yourself under one set of circumstances, you ought to, if you consider it important enough and you show the right amount of respect, you should be able to control it under those similar circumstances. So people basically do what they get away with, right? The receiver, another thing that can lead to a communication failure is when the receiver is unable to understand the message. Again, we said that it can be because of the sender or it can be the receiver. The receiver is unable to understand the message. The receiver is distracted from listening or does not want to listen, perhaps because of disinterest, mistrust, fear of being persuaded, or some other reason. Or the receiver adds his or her interpretation to the message or misses ideas that are too threatening to hear. Okay, another, let's see if we can keep up with our things here. Receiver adds his or her interpretation to the message. Okay. Let's take a look at the effects of poor interpersonal relationships. I say the truth of the matter is that any time that you're in a conflict, what happens to your insides? You know, some people say, well, they thrive on controversy. I'd have to question a person. I mean, what kind of person is it that thrives on controversy? You know, there's some people that supposedly like pain, don't they? I mean, some people that are sadistic. But what kind of person, what happens when you're always in conflict, when you're in combat? What happens physically? What happens to your insides? You just get tied up in knots, right? Build up tension. It's the same effect as any stressful situation. It is a form of stress. You have chemical rushes, imbalance in your chemicals in your body, headaches, tense muscles, can hinder your breathing, can hinder the blood flow, right? Okay. Psychologically, what can be some psychological effects of poor relationships? Depression, guilt, feeling put down, lacking in self-confidence, anxious, anger, bitterness, cynicism, attempts to dominate, manipulate, or get revenge. Okay? Now see, every one of these things that we're talking about here, every one of these could actually be the same effects as any stressful situation. You have chemical effects, you have physical effects, you have psychological effects, social, spiritual. Okay? Social could lead to verbal aggression, violence, withdrawal, breaking of previous relationships. What usually happens when, say, for example, in a marriage, and again, we can use marriage as a very prime example, because this is where you're going to have, where the rubber's going to meet the road. What's going to happen many times, and what happens most of the time, say, for example, if you have a conflict that leads to divorce, what's going to happen if you don't resolve, if you don't learn how to resolve these conflicts? You're going to continue in it. You're going to take it into the next relationship, right? And see, the truth of the matter is that a lot of people have so many unresolved issues, and they take a lot of baggage. They take a lot of baggage into the next relationship. Okay, spiritually, of course, I suppose you'd say that all interpersonal tension that's unresolved is certainly either a result or a reflection of some form of sin. And again, here I have to say that, you know, anytime you're involved in a conflict, doesn't necessarily mean that that both parties are guilty. However, I've always heard say that it takes two people to make an issue, right? It takes two people to tango. It takes, in other words, I think in every situation, especially in an intimate relationship, such as a marriage, there has to be the acceptance of responsibility, a certain amount of responsibility on each part, right? Because otherwise it would be really easy for you to point the finger and say, what is your fault? Or if you had done this. And the truth of the matter is sometimes a person reacts to some previous reaction.